My mom was a books organized alphabetically, everything has its place kind of lady. I mean, this is the woman who taught me how to organize a file cabinet well before how to ride a bike. She was also eternally optimistic. Now, I was a melancholic and pessimistic 13-year-old. I desperately wanted to understand why people did evil things. And I was constantly turning to books to try to find my answers until eventually it dawned on me that, hey, maybe my mom could actually help guide me out of this maze of questions that I was trapped in. One day, as she was cooking her famous taco casserole, main ingredient, Doritos, which tells you just how country we are, I let burst out all of these questions that were on my mind. My mom looked up from the stove and replied, "Oh, honey, you know, that stuff just gives me a headache." And I stared at my mom in utter disappointment. Realizing she was small town and small-minded, I decided right then and there that I was going to be the first person in my family to go to college. I was going to get my answers. As I gazed out the window of my studio in St. Louis, piles of course books nearby, I excitedly called my mom. Now, I was so full of myself that she'd barely said two words before I launched into this whole thing about Plato's theory of forms and then paused expectantly. When she replied yet again that this stuff just gives her a headache, well, I lost my shit. "Mom, you are worthless and stupid. I have never been understood by you. You will never understand me. I don't ever want to talk to you again." And I slammed that phone down, convinced I had done the right thing. 2 years later, crammed into a broom closet-sized dorm room at the University of Chicago, surrounded by yet more books, still lacking answers, lost in a debilitating depression. I just needed my mom. Whew, my hands were shaking as I dialed her number and my throat went immediately sandpaper dry, but I managed to croak out, "Hey, Mom. It's Rachel." And I held my breath. "Honey, I am so glad you called." And just like that, so began our Sunday chats. 5 years later, devastated from yet another failed relationship, I called my mom and I immediately declared, "Love is bullshit." And I started to spin out, but my mom interrupted me, which immediately stopped me in my tracks. And she went on to unfold an entire philosophy of love, which boiled down to never make anyone apologize for who they are and find someone who'll do the same. Man, if you could have seen my face, okay? I was like, who is this lady dropping some deep shit on me, okay? But I was so thankful that I hadn't missed out on learning from my mom in this way. Fast forward, I am living the SF life, baby. I'm eating kale. I am learning about proper pronoun use. My clothes are getting flowier by the day. Until one day the phone rang. It was my mom's landlord who called to inform me that he was going to evict her for failure to pay her rent. And I was like, dude, you have the wrong Patricia Graham, because the woman I know pays her bills religiously weeks in advance. It was then that I realized there must be something terribly, terribly wrong. And soon enough, that terribly wrong had a name. Alzheimer's. A year passed. I had fallen in love. I was running my business full time, and my mom was living with my sister and my nephew, and everything was getting back to normal until the phone rang. This time, it was my nephew. Auntie Rachel, we can't get Grandma to eat or take a bath. I don't think we can take care of her anymore. His words landed like lead in my belly, and all I wanted to do was run away from this problem. But that's not my style. A month later, I walked into my mom's room, lovingly swallowing the thick smell of decay. I pulled a chair up next to her bed, and I took her withered hand in mine. Hey, Mom, it's Rachel. Her blank stare shredded me. It felt like all of my bones were dissolving. And then somehow, she woke out of this trapped mind and said, "Oh, there's my Rita Hayworth." This has always been her favorite nickname for me. And so I felt my spine straighten, relieved that I hadn't been forgotten yet. A few days later, we settled her into her room at the nursing home. Pictures of the family on the wall, great-grandma Sarcoxie's quilt at the end of her bed, all of her books organized alphabetically on her shelf. And I showered her with hugs and kisses, and I promised that I would continue to call her every week. These days, we video chat. And there are times. There are times when I look into her eyes and I can't find her. And she can't find me. And it's in those moments that everything inside of me screams, "Please, Mom, recognize me." But she can't. That's not her fault. Honestly, folks, there are days when I long for her death. Rather than continue to endure all of these many deaths, dead is the woman who puts all of the camping equipment in order meticulously. Dead is the woman who finishes Wheel of Fortune puzzles in 30 seconds or less. No shit. Dead is the woman who's able to guide me and protected me when she discovered I was being sexually abused by my grandfather. But alive, oh man, alive is the woman who laughs easily. Alive is the woman who still loves to read, even if it is the same sentence over and over. Alive is the woman who is affectionate and kind and a jokester. Seriously, she keeps pulling the fire alarm because she thinks it's funny to watch people run. Fuck. Oh my God. Alive is the woman who taught me how to love. So, I will be her Rita Hayworth. Or a complete stranger. who just happens to want to talk with her. And I will cherish every single conversation until the phone no longer rings.